Dudes, you know, if you're an artist, you're probably very passionate. You're probably very enthusiastic about making things like myself. And the problem, though, is that sometimes it can be hard to know what to work on, what to put your focus on. And, you know, it looks like somebody commented, Spooky Jones seems to have the same problem. Spooky Jones wrote in with this question. He says, what do you do if you can't settle on something? I keep jumping around. I've been working around game concept art and 3D modeling, but I keep jumping back to drawing and then back to 3D modeling. Also, how do you finish something? And I think these two questions do go hand in hand. And hey, you know, there's no better person to ask than me. I mean, what, I got a YouTube channel. I've got a comic book that I'm finishing up. I'm making art books. I'm making illustrated novels. And I'm writing a script for yet another indie game on top of running an art house where we do concept art for big AAA games. So you know me. I'm a real focused I'm a real focused dude. I can't specifically answer this for you. I can't say, hey, you should be pursuing character design because I don't know you, man. I don't know your strengths. I don't know your weaknesses. I don't know what you excel at. But I can tell you from my experience, when I'm trying to manage too many things, I do have some techniques that I use to get me back on track. Techniques that you could use to help you focus as well. So let's dig into it. First and foremost, what are you good at, man? Like, what are your strengths? This is the biggest thing that most artists are gonna totally skip in their career, and they're gonna struggle, and they're gonna wonder why. Why can't I find an opportunity with the thing I want? Well, you know, first of all, you gotta find what it is that you're good at. Different people are gonna be good at different things. Some people would be better at environment concept art, and even if their passion is in characters, but if they're really good at environment concept art, they should be putting their energy towards that and getting employment as an environment concept artist. There's a lot of jobs for that, you know? I've met a lot of artists that aren't able to identify what their strengths are. Maybe they're really good at rendering materials and textures. Well, you know what? There's a great job for that in the game industry. It's hard for these big studios to find people who want to work on UI, to work on the graphics for the icons, to work on the graphics for the pause menus, and the basically just the user interface or user experience. And most artists are going to go, no, you don't understand. My dream is to be the monster designer or the character designer. I just want to paint beautiful women for video games. But are you better than everybody else at doing that? Are you the standout at that? Or are you going to have more opportunities, you know, at something that you're good at versus what it is that you're dreaming of? Todd McFarlane, one of the most legendary comic book artists in the world, he always wanted to be a professional baseball player. And who knows if he was any good at that, but I'll tell you what, that guy could draw like a mofo. And he sold millions and millions of copies of his comic books for Marvel and for his own comic book Spawn. And, you know, the guy, he still gets to enjoy the thing that he loves in his pastime, but he played off of his strengths in life. So find and identify what it is that you have, what you can do that has the most value to other people. Second thing that I'm going to recommend is that you write out all of your projects, all of the things that you want to pursue. Write them out onto individual post-it notes, whether it's, I'm going to make that comic book about that thing. I want to do that short story about that other thing. I'm going to work on my character design portfolio so I can get a job at that other studio. And don't hold back, man. Like, anything goes. Anything you ever dreamed of, put it on its own card. But be specific. Like, if you got two different comic book ideas, that's two different post-it cards. The next thing you're going to do is lay them out on the floor, and you're going to work on prioritizing each one of those. Which one is more likely to get pushed towards the top of your list? What are the deciding factors? You know, I would suggest that you start with a process of elimination. What do you stink at? And what's probably not gonna get as much traction for you? Another factor might be momentum. You know, how far along is that project? Sometimes if I've got a project that's like 80% done because I've been, you know, it's been in the back burner for a couple of years, well, I might just very well go ahead and wrap up that project, put that at the top of the list because, damn, I'm just so close already and I've got the energy and it feels real good to finish something. You could take some of these cards and just throw them right in the garbage right now. If they're just a pipe dream that's like, I have no idea how to do that thing. I've never even investigated it. I have no concept of, you know, how it's made. Then maybe you need to just take that one and throw it right in the garbage, or change the context of that post-it note to say, set aside 30 minutes to study that thing that you want to pursue, you know, each week. And that can be something that you work into your cycle, because this is something that I've been doing and this has been working for me. I actually time box out my projects based on day. I used to do it by the hour, which was just too intense and it's too rigid. So what I do is I take that list and I've got my post-it cards and I know that, well, this is the project that I'm working on today. So it's at the top of my stack of projects or on my post-it board. And that's the one that I'm working on my Mondays and Tuesdays, for instance. Like, so Mondays and Tuesdays, I work on YouTube videos and I work on my Gumroad content. So I'm making workshops and essentially that is my job. I work Mondays and Tuesdays, that is my job. My second job is contract concept art, where I'm managing other artists. So that does take several hours every day. And that is kind of a priority. So that one kind of takes precedent over my own personal projects, because my own personal projects, I can work late to get that done, but the work for the client has to get done during the day. When you've got other people counting on you, that kind of becomes a higher priority. And when it's your income involved, it's a very high priority. So essentially, don't throw out the high priority project just because you're dreaming of doing that other thing that makes no money. Plus, of course, if you got like a rich uncle or something, so if you don't need to worry about money at all, then none of this really matters. Just do whatever you feel like every day, you know. Man, that must be nice. So through my Monday through Friday, I mean, that's my priority. Whatever the client needs, I drop whatever I'm doing to make sure that they're happy. So if you have customers that are counting on you to deliver product, well, that's got to be at the top of your list too. Wednesdays through Friday are when I get to work on that rotating list of the remainder, but I try to time box it so that each day it's really just one project plus whatever client needs are. So I might be chipping away at, you know, for instance, right now I'm wrapping up the Creed Reimaginary comic book. It was a hugely successful Indiegogo campaign. There are a lot of customers who are counting on that book to come out. And I might be painting away on pages on that one. And suddenly one of my artists says, hey, I don't understand how to get this material rendered correctly. So I have to go in and stop what I'm doing and make sure that that's a priority. That one gets taken care of. Then I stay in my office a little late that day and make up the time on the Creed Reimaginary comic to make sure that it stays on schedule. What I'm going to recommend is that with each one of these goals that you have, make sure that you're doing small scope for them. So for instance, if you're making comic books, you know, if you've never made a comic book before, but your dream is to make comic books, you should focus on making short 8 to 10 page short comic books first. Get good at that. Get good at finishing that and assessing how you could improve, you know, and then that way also that time boxed project that goes into your calendar, that doesn't end up taking 6 months of your life, because a marathon you have to train up for. You can't expect yourself to jump into a 5-year project if you've never made anything like that before in the past at all. You need to have a goalpost in mind and you need to know where that goalpost is. So define those things, put them into a calendar. Don't like stop halfway through and go, oh, it sucks, I'm just going to quit. You know, like, no. Finish that small scope project. If your goal is to make indie games, it's like, you know, make small indie games first and finish them. Get comfortable with the process of finishing them. I learned so much from releasing my first game on Steam. So when I do another one, it's going to be so much smoother and I'm going to do so much better. It's going to perform better than that first game. The items on your list, they're going to move around. Those post-it notes are going to move around, you know, because some projects are going to fall through, you know. If you're relying on other people, like say you got partners that they had another project that came up and you've got to reassess, and then other projects might end up becoming a higher priority in your list of things to get done. The budget for your project may fall through, or, you know, perhaps the sales just aren't there. So you've got to decide, well, at that time, well, I think it's time that I drop that project. Maybe some projects get bumped down the list, so far down the list that you don't get to them for 2 more years. But that's just the way it's going to go, because you do have to continually make income and you do have to continually assess what your highest priority projects are. But if all of this making of lists and making of post-it notes and time boxing and scheduling, if all that just, you know, bugs you and you're just like, nah, man, I'm just going to go wherever, you know, the wind takes me. I'm going to just be an artist that wanders the earth and whatever hopeful opportunities land my way are the ones that I'll take. Well, then what are you doing watching this video, man? This is about getting stuff done. That's about Daydream Johnny's. All this stuff is like CEO stuff, right? It's all business, right? But guess what? You are the CEO of your life. And if you're not making choices and making decisions and pursuing what you want out of it, or at least assessing what your capabilities are and pursuing your strengths, well, then you're going to get whatever lands your way. It might be something you don't want, and you got nobody to blame but yourself. Damn, that's cold. That is stone cold, but it's the truth. And that's what you come to me for, baby, because it gives you the truth. I suppose even if it's unpleasant to hear. Anyway, those are the strategies that I use. And I want you to know, I still struggle with these things too. It is an ever-present, constant challenge. That's a good thing, man. If it was easy, it wouldn't be anything worth admiring. It wouldn't be anything worth aspiring to. It would just be something everybody can do. There's nothing special about that. To do something extraordinary, you're going to have to do something extraordinary. That sounds so dumb and obvious, but it's true. And yet we still want to deny that that's true. It's like you're going to have to do something exceptional. And that means really challenging yourself with something like a schedule if you want to get something done and do something impressive. So anyway, that's my deep cuts for the week. That's my cold, hard lesson for the week. Anyway, I hope any of these things helped you, if nothing else, to just get a dialogue going, to just something that you might consider. Strategy, if you will, to complete those projects or to turn your attention towards a singular focus, if only for a period of time. And dudes, I would love to see your small wins. I would love to see your successes. I would love to see if any of these things helped you at all. So please do leave a comment below the video. Whether you loved it or hate it, I would love to see you come back next week. I'm here every Wednesday. And until next time, dudes, I'll catch y'all mañana de bon and ciao, baby. Oh, yeah. Dude, what the heck is Twilight Monk? Which is the first book to buy? I get this question a lot, so I wanted to clarify. If you don't know already, yes, I've worked on many successful video games, but now I'm making illustrated novels and art books. And the order that you should pick them up in if you're interested in the world of Twilight Monk is to start with the book called The World of Twilight Monk. This is an illustrated art book, but it features a lot of backstory on characters and locations and populations and the different cities and what they do with those cities. And this is the groundwork for all these adventures that I'm about to tell in the illustrated novels. Now, which illustrated novel should you start with if you want to pick up the Twilight Monk series and start reading about these characters? I highly recommend you start with The Secrets of Kung Fulio. The Secrets of Kung Fulio has 70 illustrations by myself and Danny Kong. It's a 50,000 word book that was written by myself and Chris Krubik. It has a lot of kung fu fantasy adventure action. It is the story of a reluctant teenage hero who has to overcome this bully who's trying to kick him out of town, basically. But he kind of totally stinks at kung fu, so he's going to need to build some alliances, and he's going to need a shortcut to ultra secret Kung Fulio mastery. It's got comedy, it's got action, it's got, it's a buddy story too, so lots of heart. Oh, just read the reviews, man. People are loving this book. And yes, the illustrated novel series is a series, in fact. So you can look forward to The Return of the Ancients, which is coming out in illustrated form later this year. You can pick up The World of Twilight Monk and Secrets of Kung Fulio, as well as many of the other comic books and illustrated novels that I've written and drawn over at aquaticmoon.com. All orders are delivered and fulfilled by Amazon, so you can read reviews and get that prime shipping, baby. I can't wait to share these kung fu adventure stories with you, and I hope you'll come along for the ride. I'd love to read your reviews as well. So dudes, that's it for me on this one. I'll catch you in the next video. Ciao.